I was asking for high fives. I've got to give you a virtual hug. Nice to see you. A big day. Congratulations. Right.
For the reception of Holy Communion, we will have two communion stations in the center aisle. We ask that the people who are seated in the side aisles, beginning from the front, make their way in a single file line to the back of the church and come around to the front to receive the Eucharist. And then when the side aisles have received communion, those who are in the middle to come forward from the front in a single file line, and just to maintain social distancing when we're doing that. After you receive communion, if you could step to the side and to remove your mask there to consume it, and then to return to your seat after that. For my brother priests who are here, we will receive communion by intinction from the altar. So we will lead you to the altar from two stations on the front end of the altar. There is a purificator, there will be half posts, and there will be two chalices to simply dip the bread, the body of Christ into the precious blood to receive communion via intinction there. And now, and at the end, we ask that everyone also in moving around maintain their distance and maintain the precautions that are in place. Now, Father Charles would like to welcome all of us.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
And welcome, St. James. Since we are told we need to wear masks, here I can't put my mask on my face. But here I am. As the people of God, here at St. James, I'll say it's about time we count our blessings and fortunes. We certainly thank God for being so gracious to raise from among us one more person to serve him and his people at the altar. And you know the person I'm talking about? Brendan Foley. We thank Bishop Lucia for his decision to have the seminarians, Brendan Foley, Dennis Walker, and John Moore Drew, be ordained in their own home parishes. We warmly welcome Bishop Lucia and his predecessor, Bishop Cunningham, to our parish. Bishop Lucia, we thank you for considering Brendan Foley, our seminarian, as a candidate for the major orders in our Catholic Church, and for accepting to be here in person to ordain this young man to the diaconate. We hope this will only be one of the many ordinations to take place here at St. James, as I also appeal to you parents and the younger people here, mostly the younger people, to consider taking the path of Brennan, the path that Brennan has undertaken. And please, parents, and all God's people of goodwill, support our cause, encourage seminarians, and pray for them. Once again, Bishop Lucia, Bishop Cunningham, welcome St. James. Thank you all for being here today. Now, at the end of the ceremony, do me a favor, please. At the end of the ceremony, do me a favor. Do not leave this place without stopping down in the parish hall for some refreshment. I'll be in big trouble with those who have prepared the meal. Do me that favor. Once again, thank you for being here. God bless you all.
course, I want to greet in a special way Brendan and his family and his friends who gather here today, along with the Church of Syracuse. Especially, I want to thank Bishop Cunningham for his presence among us and for joining us for this diaconate ordination. Today can't be a better day to have an ordination, because it's the Feast of the Sacred Heart, Feast of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, a feast that calls to mind God's love made flesh. And that's what the sacraments are all about, especially the sacraments of service, of which Holy Orders is one. That call to serve God's people in imitation of Christ, bearing his love to those we meet along the way. And so as we gather around the Lord's holy altar, we pray for Brendan, that he will be an apostle of love. But even more now, as we prepare to enter into this celebration of the mystery of Christ's love for us, we acknowledge first those times we've not lived on in that love, and we seek the Lord's pardon and strength.
Lord Jesus, you came to reconcile us to one another and to the Father.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus,
you
are the wounds of sin and religion and
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the seed for
blood. He has chosen you from among all the nations on the face of the earth to be a people peculiarly his own. It was not because you are the largest of all nations that the Lord set his heart on you and chose you, for you are really the smallest of all nations. It was because the Lord loved you, and because of his fidelity to the oath he had sworn to his fathers, that he brought you out with his strong hand from the place of slavery and ransomed you from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Understand then that the Lord your God is God indeed, the faithful God who keeps his merciful covenant down to the thousandth generation towards those who love him and keep his commandments, but who repays with destruction a person who hates him. He does not dally with such a one, but makes them personally pay for it. You shall therefore carefully observe the commandments, the statutes, and the decrees that I enjoin on you today. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
God.
of St. John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is of God. Everyone who loves is begotten by God and knows God. Whoever is without love does not know God, for God is love. In this way, the love of God was revealed to us. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might have life through him. In this is love. Not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as expiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also must love one another. No one has ever seen God. Yet, if we love one another, God remains in us, and his love is brought to perfection in us. This is how we know that we remain in him and he in us, that he has given us of his Spirit. Moreover, we have seen and testify that the Father sent his Son as Savior of the world. Whoever acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God remains in him and he in God. We have come to know and believe in the love God has for us. God is love, and whoever remains in love remains in God and God in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
At that time, Jesus exclaimed, "I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you have revealed them to little ones. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves, for my yoke is easy and my burden light." The Gospel of the Lord.
Let Brendan Daniel Foley, who is to be ordained a deacon, come forward.
Most Reverend Father, Holy Mother Church asks you to ordain this man, our brother, to the responsibility of the diaconate.
Do you know him to be worthy?
After inquiry among the Christian people, and upon the recommendation of those responsible, I testify that he has been found worthy.
Relying on the help of the Lord God and our Savior Jesus Christ, we choose this man, our brother, for the order of the diaconate.
Thanks.
Isn't that then what a sacrament is all about? An outward sign, a living sign of God's presence in the world today. My brother Brendan, today you have come to this house of God to offer yourself as a sacrament for the church through the gift of holy orders. This afternoon, in imitation of Christ himself, you lay down your life in diaconal service to the people of God to be a much-needed living sign of God's presence in the world today. It is most appropriate that you do so on these days in which we call to mind the Sacred Heart of Jesus and the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Today's solemnity commemorates and celebrates the mercy of God, often graphically represented by the heart. Tomorrow's feast of the Immaculate Heart of our Mother Mary illustrates for all of us, no matter our vocation in life, the call to radiate, to magnify the love of God to our neighbor, especially to God's little ones. Brendan, in this particular moment of human history, it is most important for you as well as all of us to recall that the message of Jesus appealed to those who were on the outskirts of society and religious life of his day. This was a message of good news to those who had been locked out from the benefits of society. Laborers who were cheated wages. Slaves who by definition did not enjoy freedom. Women who were thought of as mere property and had no rights. Along with all those burdened because systematic oppression kept them away from power, wealth, privilege, and status. My brother, you must be a bearer of the good news of Jesus Christ today, not merely by preaching the message, but even more important, by making a sermon of it by the life you lead. Through your own gospel living, as a disciple of Jesus called to imitate his servanthood, you are called to place your lot with the little ones and accompany them on their way. Our leader, our master, is meek and humble and invites us to do the same. As Pope Francis has instructed the ordained of the Church of Rome, using the image of the church as a field hospital, get out from your rectories and go and meet people where they are at. So, sisters and brothers, what does it mean to be a deacon? What is Brendan getting himself into, so to speak? Well, beloved brothers and sisters, since this our son, who is your relative and friend, is now to be advanced to the order of deacons, consider carefully the nature of the rank of the church to which he is about to be raised. Strengthened by the gift of the Holy Spirit, he will help the bishop and his priest in the ministry of the word, of the altar, and of charity, showing himself to be a servant of all. As a minister of the altar, he will proclaim the gospel, prepare the sacrifice, and distribute the Lord's body and blood to the faithful. Furthermore, it will be his duty, at the bishop's direction, to exhort believers and unbelievers alike and to instruct them in holy doctrine. He will preside over public prayer, administer baptism, assist at and bless marriages, bring viaticum to the dying, and conduct funeral rites. Consecrated by the laying on of hands that comes down to us from the apostles, and bound more closely to the service of the altar, he will perform works of charity in the name of the bishop or the pastor. With the help of God, he is to go out about all these duties in such a way that you will recognize him as the disciple of him who came not to be served, but to serve. Now, dear son, you are to be raised to the order of the diaconate. The Lord has set an example that just as he himself has done, you also should do. As a deacon, that is, as a minister of Jesus Christ, who came among his disciples as one who served, to do the will of God from the heart, serve the people in love and joy, as you would the Lord. Since no one can serve two masters, look upon all defilement and avarice as serving false gods. Since by your own free choice you present yourself for the order of the diaconate, you should be a man of good reputation, filled with wisdom and the Holy Spirit, as were those once chosen by the apostles for the ministry of charity. You will exercise your ministry committed to the celibate state. Know that celibacy is both a sign of pastoral charity and an inspiration to it, as well as a source of spiritual fruitfulness in the world. Compelled by the sincere love of Christ the Lord, and living this state with total dedication, you will cling to Christ more easily with an undivided heart. You will free yourself more completely for service of God and the human family, and minister more effectively in the work of spiritual rebirth. Firmly rooted and grounded in faith, you are to show yourself, Brendan, chaste and beyond reproach before God and the human family, as is proper for a minister of Christ and of a steward of God's mysteries. Never allow yourself to be turned away from the hope offered by the gospel. Now you are not only a hearer of the gospel, but also its minister. Hold the mystery of faith with a clear conscience, expressed by your actions. Christian people, brought to life by the Spirit, may be a pure offering, accepted by God. Brother, as you contemplate Jesus' Sacred Heart and see it magnified in the life of our Mother Mary, remember that his love for you isn't meant to end with you. Through the Holy Spirit, he wants to fan the flames of his love so that you can share it with everyone you encounter. Then on the last day, when you go out to meet the Lord, you will be able to hear him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord." Dear son, before you enter the order of the diaconate, you must declare before the people your intentions to undertake this office. Brendan, do you resolve to be consecrated for the church's ministry by the laying on of my hands and the gift of the Holy Spirit?
I do.
Do you resolve to discharge the office of deacon with humble charity in order to assist the priestly order and to benefit the Christian people?
I do.
Do you resolve to hold fast to the mystery of faith with a clear conscience, as the apostle urges, and to proclaim this faith in word and deed according to the gospel and the church's tradition?
I do.
Do you resolve to keep forever this commitment to remain celibate as a sign of your dedication to Christ the Lord, for the sake of the kingdom of heaven and service of God and man?
I do.
Do you resolve to maintain and deepen the spirit of prayer that is proper to your way of life, and in keeping with this spirit and what is required of you, to celebrate faithfully the liturgy of the hours with and for the people of God, and indeed for the whole world?
I do.
Do you resolve to conform your way of life always to the example of Christ, of whose body and blood you are a minister at the altar?
I do, with the help of God.
Brendan, do you promise respect and obedience to me and my successors?
I do.
And may God, who has begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment. My dear people, let us pray that God, the all-powerful Father, will mercifully pour out the grace of his blessing on this his servant, whom in his kindness he raises to the holy order of the diaconate.
Mother.
Lord God, mercifully hear our prayers and graciously accompany with your help what we undertake by virtue of our office. Sanctify by your blessing this man we present, for in our judgment we believe him worthy to exercise sacred ministries through Christ our Lord. Draw near, we pray, Almighty God, giver of every grace, who apportion every order and assign every office, who remain unchanged but make all things new. In your eternal providence, you make a provision for every age, as you order all creation through him who is your word, your power, and your wisdom, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You grant that the church, his body, are adorned with manifold heavenly graces, drawn together in the diversity of its members, and united by a wondrous bond to the Holy Spirit, should grow and spread forth to build up a new temple. And as once you chose the sons of Levi to minister in the former tabernacle, so now you establish three ranks of ministers in their sacred offices, to serve in your name. And so, in the first days of your church, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, your sons apostles appointed seven men of good repute to assist them in the daily ministry, that they might devote themselves more fully to prayer and preaching of the word. By prayer and the laying on of hands, they entrusted to these chosen men the ministry of serving at table. We beseech you, Lord, look with favor on this servant of yours, who will minister at your holy altar, and whom we now humbly dedicate to the office of deacon. Send forth upon him, Lord, we pray, the Holy Spirit, that he may be strengthened by the gift of your sevenfold grace for the faithful carrying out of the work of the ministry. May there abound in him every gospel virtue, unfeigned love, concern for the sick and poor, unassuming authority, purity of innocence, and the observance of spiritual discipline. May your commandments shine forth in his conduct, so that by the example of his way of life, he may inspire the imitation of your holy people. In offering the witness of a clear conscience, may he remain strong and steadfast in Christ, so that by imitating on earth your Son, came not to be served, but to serve, he may be found worthy to reign in heaven with him, who lives and reigns with you in unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated.
There is no room.
expiation of our offenses through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For raised up high on the cross, he gave himself up for us with a wonderful love, and poured out blood and water from his pierced side, the wellspring of the church's sacraments, so that won over to the open heart of the Savior, all might draw water joyfully from the springs of salvation. So with all the angels and saints, we praise you as without end we acclaim.
Whose faith and devotion are known to you.
In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Thank you.
Let us pray. May this sacrament of charity, O Lord, make us fervent with the fire of holy love, so that drawn always to your Son, we may learn to see him in our neighbor, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I just want to thank everyone who's been part of this special day in preparation. Certainly Father Sight and the Office of Worship, folks here at St. James, all who have played such an important part in bringing this day to fruition. I know we wondered when would it get here, especially after we had to postpone the April ceremony. But I have to tell you, Deacon Brendan, I don't think there's a more beautiful occasion to be ordained than on this Feast of the Sacred Heart. And I just want to congratulate you. For me, it's a privilege because Brendan's my first ordination. Make you an imitator of his Son, Jesus Christ, and a minister of unity and peace in the world.